Hi, hello everyone. I'm a tutor of Uplatz. This is MongoDB session part 15. To know more about us, please use this website address which I have mentioned in my presentation. So let's see the agenda for today's session. Today we are going to discuss about administration and MongoDB backup methods. So like administrator is the one who address the ongoing operation and maintain our MongoDB instances and deployment. So after the development cycle, this is the person one who take care of our ongoing operation and maintenance of our MongoDB instances. So these are the recommended platform which we have used in a MongoDB. So this is Amazon, Debian, Ubuntu, Windows Server, so etc. So it is supported on all the platform because it is an open source. So next is MongoDB data path. So the files in the DB path directory must correspond to the configured storage engine. So it will not start if the DB path contains a data file. It will only created if there is a specific, it should be created by any of the specified storage engine. So until then it will not start or it will not contain any of the data files. So the MongoDB must possess the read and write permission for that particular specified path. So next is WireTiger storage engine. So it will support the concurrent access by the readers and writes to the documents in the collection. So what this will do, client can read the documents while the write operation are in progress, and multi-threads can modify different documents in the collection at the same time. So next is operation checklist. So basically for in replication, it will verify all the non-hidden replica set members which is identified in terms of their RAM, CPU, disk and setup. So it will also configure our OBLOX suit size for our use case. It will ensure that replica set includes at least 3 data bearing nodes which that should run with journally, and it will have the right majority concern. And also it should use the host name when configuring replica set members rather than our IP address. It will ensure the full bidirectional network connectivity between all MongoDB instances, and it's also ensure that each host can resolve itself. It will ensure that our replica set contains the odd number of voting members. So if there is any even number means we need to add the arbitrary. So and also it will ensure it has 0 or 1 vote. For high availability, we need to deploy a replica set in minimum of 3 data centers. Next is for sharding. So we need to place our config servers on the dedicated hardware for optimal performance. So we need to ensure the hardware that has enough RAM to hold the data files entirely in the memory that is in a dedicated storage. For that, we need to deploy a Mongo routes in a production configuration guideline. And also we need to ensure that is a bi-directional network connectivity between the MongoDB, Mongo and config servers. Next is journaling of WireTiger storage engine. That for that we need to ensure that all the instances are using this journaling. For that we need to place the journal on the low latency disk for write loads, so it will not affect our snapshot backstep as well as the database will reside in separate volumes. So next is backup. For this it will schedule the test of our periodic backup, and then it will restore the process to have the time estimated on our hand. It will verify the functionality as well as. So next is monitoring. For that it will include the replication log, replication OBLOX window, assertion queues and page fault. So this monitor hardware will satisfy all our server. In particular way, it will attention to our disk size, CPU and available disk space. So in absence of disk monitoring, so if there is no size or no disk space for that, it will create a dummy of 4 GB file on the storage path, and then It will ensure the available space if the disk is full. So if not, we are using CRON and DEF. So it will create a lot on high water mark. So next is how we can balance our load. So we can configure a load balancers in a sticky session or client affinity. So for that, we are using the set of components. So next is our development checklist. For this, we need to concentrate first on data durability. That we need to ensure all our replica set includes at least 3 data bearing nodes with write majority concern, and also it should require a replica set wide data durability, and it ensure that all the instances are using journaling. So next is we need to concentrate on schema design. So the data in MongoDB should have a dynamic schema, which means we can structure our schema design whenever we want. So it does not enforce our document size. So for that, the collection often holds a document which is highly homogeneous structure. So the next, it is like determine the set of the collection and the index are required to support our queries. So with the exception of that underscore ID, we must create all indexes explicitly. So it does not automatically create any index other than underscores ID. For that, we need to concentrate more on designing our schema. So the document size is very important because the JSON document type limit is 16 MB per document. If we exceeds that, we need to use the grid FS, which we have already discussed in our previous session in the storage part. So next is replication. So we need to use the odd number of replica set members to ensure that election proceeds successfully. So if you have any even number of members, we need to use the arbiter to get the odd number of votes. So as you develop and operate operation with the MongoDB, we need to analyze the performance of the application and its database. So next is locking performance. Next, we need to concentrate how to locking a system, a data consistency. So for that, logs.time occurring micros. What it will do, it will occur a wait count and give the appropriate average wait time for particular log mode. So logs.deadlock count, it will provide the number of times that log encounter deadlocks. So the next is global log.currentQueue.total. So it is consistently high, and there is also chance that large number of requests are waiting for the log. So this indicates a possible concurrency issue that may affecting the performance. So if the global log.total time is high relative to uptime, the database has existing in the log state for the significant amount of time. So number of connections. So in some cases, the number of connection between the application and the database may become high, and it for handling a server request may become difficult. So in that, we have two fields in a connection container. So one is connection.current. It will tell the total number of the current clients that connected to our database instance, and connection.available, it will give the total number of unused connections available for the new client. So if there are numerous concurrent application requests, so we have a trouble keeping with demand. So in that case, you need to increase the capacity of our deployment. So next is database profiling. With the help of that, it will give the detailed information about the operation against the MongoDB instances. So you can enable and configure the profiling on a database on all the MongoDB instances. It will affect only the single MongoDB instance. It will not propagate to the replica set or shared cluster. So if it is level is zero, means if the profiling level is off, and it will does not collect any data. So this is basically a default. So if it is one, means it will collect the operation data of operation that takes longer than the value of slow embers. So if it is 2, means the profiler will collect the data for all the operation. So the profiler entries diagnosed for read and write operation. So
basically the query hash to help the identity slow queries with the same query shape, and plain cache key to provide more insight into the query plan. So depending on the host operating system, the diagnostic data may include one or four following statistics, which is like CPU utilization, memory utilization, and disk utilization related to the performance, which FDDC does not include the data related to storage capacity, network performance statistics. So which is like it will only capture the metadata and it will not capture or inspect any network packets. So how to enable and disable, how to enable and configure a database profiling. So we can enable and the database profiling for MongoDB instances. So this section uses the Mongo shell helper, which is like db.set profiling level to enable. So for that, when you enable a profiling for MongoDB instances, we need to set the profiling level value should be greater than zero. This before the profiler creates a data in a collection, this profiler, what will do, it will create the system.profile in our collection. So once after creating that, we can enable the profile or we can set a profiling level in our database. So for that, we need to use to set or enable, we need to use the db.set profiling level. So this is how we need to do. So db.set profiling level I have passed to. So for that, I have written if OK1 means the operation is now get succeeded. So now we can verify the new setting and see check the profiling level section. So for that, we can specify the threshold for slow operation. So by default, the slow operation threshold is 100 milliseconds. So to change the slow operation threshold, we need to specify the desired threshold value in one of the following ways, which is like we can set the value of slow MS using the profile command or db.set profiling level, or else we can set the value of slow MS from the command line, or else in the configuration file we can set the value of the slow OP threshold MS. So for example, now I have created my profiling level to 1 and I have set my slow operation threshold to 20 milliseconds. So now I can use db.set profiling level to configure slow MS. So for the Mongo's, the slow MS and sample rate configuration settings will affect only the diagnostic log and not the profiler, since the profiler is not available on Mongo's. For that example, this Mongo instance slow operation threshold for logging a slow operation. So what I have done, either I can use the db.set profiling level helper method, or else with the command line startup, I can set the value from slow OP sample rate, or I can change in the configuration line file for the, I can set a value for slow OP sample rate. So here, it should, by default, it should have 1.0, which meaning the operation or profile. So when the sample rate is set between 0 and 1, the database with the profiling level 1 will only profile a random sample percentage according to the sample rate. For example, the following method will set the profiling level for Mongo to 1 and set the profile to sample 42%. So db.set profiling level 1 and sample rate to 42%. We can also use db.set profiling level to configure slow MS. For example, the following sets the MongoDB instance sampling rate. So db.set profiling level 0 and sample rate is 0.2. Meaning, how can we check the profiling level? To view the profiling level, so we need to use this db.get profiling status. So by doing this, it will give the was slow MS sample rate and OK1. So was is like it indicates the current profiling, and slow MS field is indicating the operation threshold in millisecond beyond the operations are considered slow. So this sample rate field indicates the percentage of slow operation that should be profiled. to return only profile level, we need to use the helper method is like db.getProfilingLevel. So it will only give the profiling level either 0, 1 or 2. So how can we disable profiling? So we are using the following helper method in Mongo shell. So set profiling level should be 0. So which means it is like deleting. So how we can enable the profiling for entire MongoDB instances? So for development purpose in testing environment, we can enable the database profiling for entire MongoDB instances. So the profiling level is applied to all the database provided by the MongoDB instances. So to enable the profiling for MongoDB instances, we need to pass the following options to MongoDB. So MongoDB --profile1--slow-ms15 and --slow-op sample rate. So database profiling and sharding. So we cannot enable profiling on Mongo instances. To enable the profiling in the sharded cluster, we need to enable the profiling for each Mongo instances in a cluster. So for that, we can set this --slow-ms slow-op sample rate. So in either in a configuration file or either in the MongoDB shell to diagnose the log for slow operation. How can we view the profiler data? So the database profiler logs information about the database operation in the system.profile collection. To view the profiling, the query system.profile collection will be used. So we can use the comment operator to add a data to the query to predict more easier analyzing data from the profiler. So we can also use this operator. So now how to some examples to profiler data queries. So for explanation, so to return the most recent 10 log entries in the system profile collection, so we can run this query. So db.systemprofile.find.limit is 10, sort is -1.pretty. So it will return everything. So to run all the operation except command operation, so we need to use the dollar command. So db.systemprofile.find, OP, it's my field inside my profile, and I'm using not equal command.pretty. To return a operation for particular collection, you can run a query with this my symbol, which is the following like this. So it will return the operation in my database test collection. So MyDB is my database test collection. So it will return the operation for the particular thing. So next is to return the operation slower than 5 milliseconds, we need to run the query similar to the following. So db.system.profile find milliseconds, which is greater than 5.pretty. So to return the information from the certain time range, we can run the following query. So it is like a time range. So db.system.profile.find. So this is like TS is the field in my system collection, so greater than or less than, so it will return that. The following example looks at the time range. It will suppress the user field from the output to make easier to read and sorts the result by each operation that looks run. So I have used the sort operation. So how long the each operation will take to run, so I have also mentioned in my query. So now I can show the first recent events. So on a database that has a profiling enabled, the show profile helper method in Mongo will display the first recent operation that took in 1 milliseconds to execute. So you can use this method show profile. Next is how to change the size of the system.profile collection on primary. So for that, we need to first disable the profiling, and then we need to drop the system.profile collection. Then we need to create a new collection called system.profile and then re-enable the profiling. So what I'm going to create new system.profile collection that uses 4 million bytes subsecured MongoDB operation. So what I have to do, I have delete my profile and I have dropped my collection. Now I have created my new profiling and now I have my set enable my profiling. So this is how we need to do. So next is database profiler output. So the database profiler writes the data into the system.profile collection, so which is basically a capped collection. To view the profiler's output, we need to use normal MongoDB queries on system.profile. So this is my following example. OP, this is my query, this is my command, my database I'm using here is test. So my keys, I have keys, 101 keys, my document I have is 101. So this is my cursor ID, so this much cursor it has been used. So returned is 101 and it is like type and my database, it has a care count, wait count. So this much time it has been reading. So my collection has stored, I have using my storage here in bytes read, and my response length is this, my miles is this, and my plan summary is this. So this is how it will again, this is how my execution status will now looks. So here user and then database role here admin is using, this is not a development. So this is the admin who's running that query. So this is how my output looks. So next is system.profile.ns. So this is like the namespace, the operation targets. So the namespace in the MongoDB takes the form of the database followed by the dot and followed by the name. So next is system.profile.command. So the document containing the full command object associated with that operation. For example, the following output contains a command for the object, the collection named items in the database named test. So this is my collection named items, this is my database test. So the following example output contains a command object for get more operation generated by the command. So this is my, with the help of this cursor ID, it has been written in my collection. So I'm going to use this get more option for that my cursor ID, everything will get now written. So if the command document exists 50 kilobytes, then the document has the following form, which is like truncated and command. So this is the command if it is exists more than 50 kilobytes. So basically it will contain a document exiting the document's command field present. So if the summary still exists 50 kilobytes, then it further truncated, denoted by ellipse at the ending of the string. So next is system.profile.originating command. So for this get more operation, which retrieve the next batch of the result from the cursor, the full command is originally created by the cursor. So which is like system.profile.cursorid. So the ID of the cursor is accessed by the query and the get more option. So the next is system.profile.keysexamine. So this will rename from the system.profile.endscan. So the number of index keys that MongoDB scanned in order to carry out the operation. So in general, if keys examined is much higher than the end return, the database is scanning many index key to find the result document. So system.profile.docexamine will rename from system.profile.endscanned object. So the number of documents in the collection that MongoDB scan will carry out the operation. So next is profile.endDeleted. will give the number of document that is deleted by the particular operation, and uninsert will give the number of documents inserted by that particular operation. Nmatch will give the number of match documents that system.query condition for the update operation. So n modified means it will give the number of documents modified by the update operation. System.profile.upset, so it is like boolean that indicates the update operation. Upset option value will appears only if the upset is true. So System.profile.keyinsert, so the number of index key inserted for a given write operation. So key deleted is the number of index key that update changed in the operation. So now by changing the index key carries the small performance cost, because the database must remove the old key and then insert a new key into the B-tree index. So now restore the replica set. So restoring a database in the single node. So for that step one, we need to obtain the backup MongoDB data files. So the step two is we will drop the local database if it is exists in the backup. If you are restoring a file system backup, means we need to drop the local database, and then we can start the standalone MongoDB using the data files from the backup. So for that, I have to use this command mongodb --db/data/db. So for that, we can drop the local database. So connect the Mongo shell to the MongoDB instance, and then we can drop the local database. So for that, we can use this, use local means now we are using this local database. So then we can also drop the db.drop database, that particular database will be get dropped. So step three is we can start a new single node replica set. For that, I am start a MongoDB instance as a new single node replica set. So for that, I have specified the path to backup the data files with that particular DB path option, and the replica set name with the ripple set option. So this is my command to start the single node replica set. So --db path, this is my data DB and my ripple set. So step four is I need to connect a Mongo shell to MongoDB instances. So for that, from the same machine where we are running the MongoDB, we need to start the Mongo shell to connect the local host on default. So for that, I am simply typing Mongo. So now my server will now get start. Step five, I am initiating the new ripple set. I am using rs.initiate on one and only one member of the ripple set. So rs.initiate, this is my ID, this is my members. So I am giving only one member of my replica set. The same way I can add more members. So MongoDB provide the two options for restoring the secondary members. So for first one is we can manually copy the data files to each data directory, and the second is it will allow initial synchronize to distribute the data automatically. So first is we can copy the data files and restart. So how that we can do? For that, step one, I need to shut down the MongoDB instance that I have restored. I need to use db.shutdown server or --shutdown. After that, I need to copy the primary data directory to the secondary data directory with the help of like db path is data db by default. Next is I need to start the MongoDB instance that I have restored before. Fourth is I need to add the secondaries to my replica set with the help of the rs.add, and then I need to deploy the replica set for more information. So how we can update the secondaries using initial synchronization? I'm using the following sequence of the operations to do the initial synchronize. For that, step one, I am emptying the data directory for each prospective replica set members. For example, if the ripple set member has a storage.db path or hyphen hyphen db path of data slash db, I need to ensure that directory is exist and is empty. So step two is I need to start each ripple set member. So, and I need to add each prospective member to the replica set. For that, I need to connect to the primary using the Mongo shell and add each secondary to the replica set using rs.add method. So when I add my member to the replica set, so initial synchronization copies the data from the primary to the new member. So this is a summary. Today we have discussed what is administration, how we can backup our data, how to set up profiling, how to delete our profiling, how we can take a backup, what are the checklists and limitations for replication and starting. See you all on my next session too. If you have any queries, please write to info@uplatz.com. Thank you.